This episode is sponsored by Brilliant. SpaceX Starship updates and Starship user guide reveals major Starship feature. My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. In Boca Chica, fast iteration is key. For the past few months, we've seen prototypes being rolled down to the launch site pretty much every few weeks. These tests, of course, are meant to advance the project. SpaceX needs proof of concept for various aspects of their Starships. Since it rolled out to the test site on Sunday of last week, serial number 3 was the focus of a lot of work for the SpaceX crew in Boca Chica. A lot of components needed for a test flight and already well known to the educated space nerd have been installed on and inside the hull. Raceways for the autogenous pressurization lines have been installed alongside the hull running from the thrust section all the way up to the top bulkheads of methane and oxygen tanks. And again, for those who do not know, a traditional rocket normally carries composite helium vessels inside its main fuel tanks. While the engines consume more and more of the propellant and oxidizer, these tanks release helium into the main tanks to keep the pressure at a constant level. As Musk goes by the rule, the best part is no part, though, he is using a different method to keep the pressure inside the tanks stable. The plan is to feed gaseous half-burned propellant from the engines back into the tanks in a constant stream. This method gets rid of the otherwise needed helium tanks and in theory saves weight and complexity. Also, helium has to be brought to Mars to be able to use it as a pressurization method on the way back to Earth. Keep in mind that Starships are supposed to generate all the fuel in situ or on site on Mars for a return trip, and helium would be yet another component SpaceX would have to bring or produce on Mars for the return trip. So SpaceX has been working for a while on autogenous pressurization, and it's one of the main design components for the Raptor engine fuel cycle. Now, if we take a look at this contraption, it's sitting right under the lower bulkhead and directly above the to-be-mounted Raptor engines. Here's one possible explanation for what it does. It's a bit hard to see, but it consists of 3x2 tubes, each going almost one full circle around the thrust puck. One for methane, one for oxygen, times 3 for the number of engines. They are each connected to outlets towards the hull, and those in return are connected to the raceway tubes going up on the outside of the hull back towards the main tanks. This most likely is a heat exchanger system for the autogenous pressurization system. Hot exhaust gas, directly taken from the turbopumps of the Raptor engines, is directed into these pipes and then runs in circles around the lower bulkhead. While running through this pipe system, the gas loses a bit of its heat to be cool enough to be fed into the raceways. SpaceX just wants to give the gas time to get a more favorable temperature before it's inserted into the main tanks again. This also is a perfect example for why I'm having so much fun to make these videos for the community. There are rabbit holes all over the Starship project, and sometimes reverse engineering all these components feels a bit like recreating the prototypes. One detail about the latest Starship prototype gets lost quickly. Look at the hull. See any differences to serial number 1? Right, the COPV tanks and all other attached systems on the outside now form a line. They're not nearly as much randomly placed everywhere on the hull anymore. This will enable SpaceX to cover them up with aerodynamic covers for a possible flight, and this brings serial number 3 much closer to an actual flight design again. The COPVs seem to be forming their own raceway now, 90 degrees rotated to those of the autogenous pressurization. Going back to the construction site, there is an equal amount of new activity happening. The possible lower part of the integrated header tank has been spotted on site. It possibly fits together with the upper half spotted a while ago. The top methane bulkhead would have a hole on top where the first part attaches, and this new half would then be inside the methane tank itself. The reason for this design? It frees up space inside the methane tank, reduces weight as part of the top bulkhead is now used as part of the header tank, and it lifts the center of mass up slightly again. All these design changes are nuances on the way to the perfect prototype and are a way of development only available if you have this kind of very fast iteration. And SpaceX is very fast indeed. New bulkheads and parts for even more have been spotted on site. Here you can see one of those top bulkheads. In this case, the old variant again. So this might be the top bulkhead for Starship Serial Number 4, and the new header tank design might first be pressure tested at the launch site before SpaceX proceeds with using the new tech directly on a prototype intended for flight. And SpaceX is already busy preparing new jigs for more Starship segments. Stacking of Serial Number 4 has not started yet, so this might be the jig either for the new engine bay or for the upper part of the new Serial Number 4 tank section to be started rather soon. Work has continued on the nose cone as well. SpaceX has attached several mounting points or outlets. It is really hard to tell at the moment, but my guess is that these are some sort of anchor points, as they seem to be in a horizontal configuration, whereas an outlet would not have to be horizontal. It's hard to tell, but there seem to be 6 of them on the nose cone. So they most likely are not for fin attachment if SpaceX has not changed the design from 2 canard fins to 6 of them. As we can see by the weld marks around the square holes, there is a rather large base connected to them on the inside. This in return shows that they will be able to handle rather large loads of force. SpaceX is also almost done with the framework for their new and much more permanent manufacturing building. Where at first the speculations ranged from a high bay for Super Heavy to another windbreaker, it now became a much lower construction with one single gate in front. What exactly it will be used for in the end is impossible to say at the moment. Ring manufacturing, workshop, or even an engine workshop for future Raptor deliveries would be on the list of possible use cases. Super Heavy stacking, though, is off the table. If you take a closer look at the side beams of the building, you will find these ridges going all through the building's sides. These most likely are mounting points for an overhead crane system. So it's likely that the building will be used for heavier Starship parts. To follow SpaceX's Starship development is already a full-time job. This alone is testimony enough for the radically different development SpaceX is showing the world every day. Will it work out? Impossible to say. Is it absolutely remarkable already? Most definitely. Starship User Guide reveals major Starship feature. Almost everything technical comes with a user guide. Your TV has one, your car comes with one, and the same goes for rockets. And SpaceX has just released one for their future Starship customers. Every launch system comes with one. ULA's Atlas V, the Space Shuttle, and the Falcon 9 have one. And now Starship has one too. And you can guess what I did when SpaceX released it. So here it is, my official Starship user guide review. The Starship program leverages SpaceX's experience to introduce a next-generation super heavy-lift space transportation system capable of rapid and reliable reuse. That's what it says in the introduction of the document. It can be used for basically any form of cargo in 2 variants, be it resupply runs to the ISS, crew transport, satellites, or large observatories. SpaceX seems to want to achieve this with 2 variants of Starships. The crew variant and the cargo variant. The crew variant will feature private cabins, large common areas, centralized storage, solar storm shelters, and a viewing gallery. The cargo version, though, has a clue to it that we didn't know of yet. It might have a replaceable fairing section. We've already seen 2 possible layouts. The clamshell variant, with a fairing door opening like a clamshell or large mouth. Here, the payload can be integrated in multiple different versions. Side by side, stacked, single payloads. Payload adapters are legacy compatible, so customers will be able to use Falcon payload adapters. When talking about the payload integration, though, SpaceX describes the process as follows. Payloads are integrated into the Starship fairing vertically in ISO Class 8 clean rooms. Then the integrated payload stack is transferred to the launch pad and lifted onto the Starship vehicle, while maintaining the same vertical orientation throughout the entire process. So, if I got this right, the payload is integrated into the fairing and then the fairing is lifted onto the Starship vehicle. This would mean that the cargo Starships are made of 2 separate parts, an engine section and a fairing section. The same we already see in the prototype process right now. Those 2 halves then would be interchangeable. A clamshell designed as we've seen, or something like the lunar cargo unloading shown in this picture. Those are not different layout ideas. Those are different interchangeable payload fairing configurations. This would basically make the Starship the Swiss pocket knife of rockets. You could even design a fairing section specifically for a reoccurring task, such as orbit debris cleaning missions or asteroid mining. Anything would be possible with this concept. Just replace the tool on top and you have the different use case. If this is true, it would be the most brilliant fairing design concept ever done. Even more versatile than the space shuttle, which already was known to be very flexible in its abilities. If this is correct, there won't be any special Starship tanker for orbital refueling either. Just put the tanker fairing on top and you're good to go. This would be a small sensation, and I really hope it's true because I already hoped for something like this on an earlier episode last year. So SpaceX is basically giving their starships an unlimited set of abilities on the way. The limitations would only be engineering and your imagination. What if you could do the same? Just be limited by your imagination and the knowledge you possess. My sponsor Brilliant might be the right place for you if you want to widen your options. With its diverse and very large library of different knowledge fields, it can help you broaden your options vastly. Learn about space, math, physics, computer theory, and many, many other fields of STEM application. Dive into interactive content and intriguing puzzles that help you learn faster in an innovative way. By acquiring new knowledge, you broaden your horizon. Become a Swiss knife of knowledge in no time and have fun while learning new things. To widen your horizon and at the same time support What About It, go to brilliant.org/whataboutit and sign up to get access to over 60 interactive courses for free. And if you choose to get the premium subscription, the first 200 to join up through the link will get 20% off their annual premium subscription. So become a Swiss knife of knowledge with brilliant.org. Links in the description. So this wraps up today's episode of What About It? What is your favorite technical gimmick on serial number 3, and what do you think about SpaceX's brand new multi-tool approach for starships? As always, tell me in the comments. And here we are again at the Patreon and YouTube member shoutout, and every time I do this, it's a humbling experience. What these people do for the channel cannot really be put into words, as I'm not selling anything and they're not buying anything. They're giving support. Support for what you just saw. And it's incredible to get so much support from an ever-growing community, not only providing me with funds, but also ideas and research on the Discord. So show some love for them in the comments and maybe even consider becoming one yourself. And as always, there are new members on the team. Everyone, please give a warm welcome to Peter MacDonald and many others. You rock. Thank you for watching this episode of What About It, and now would be the appropriate time to hit the like button, subscribe, and don't forget to hit the bell button to actually receive a notification when I do my uploads. It's a version of support that doesn't cost a penny, and it does help me to produce more and better content. And if you do want to spend your money, consider becoming a patron and get insights into the production of What About It and chat with me on the Discord. Or you could buy yourself a new shirt on our merchandise store and look like me. There are plenty original designs available in good quality for a low price, made by a space nerd for other space nerds. It all helps me to give you the latest and greatest about space and science. I hope to see you on the next episode. Until then, have a great time. So show some love for them in the comings. Comings? Or even an engine workshop for future rapture rapture delivery.
For rocket. Orange rocket good.
Almost everything. Yes, just everything.